our Across the Aisle segment tonight. According to a new poll, 6 out of 10 Americans support President Trump's travel ban. So, with a majority of Americans supporting the law, and after the Supreme Court upheld it, why are Democrats still acting like the ban is so extreme? With me now, Democratic strategist Michael Starr Hopkins. Michael, good to see you.
Hey, Liz, how's it going?
Good, good, good to see you. I'm glad you're here today. All right, Michael, let me ask you this. A majority of Americans, 60%, 6 out of 10, say that they support President Trump's travel ban in its current form. We know that the Supreme Court, they found it to be acceptable, at least until they hear the oral arguments. My question to you is, are Democrats going to play by their own rules now? We heard after the election how often Democrats were saying, well, Hillary Clinton won the popular vote. Most people support Hillary, and we should support Hillary. Now that a majority of people support President Trump's travel ban, are Democrats in Congress going to get on board with that?
Well, I mean, just because Democrats don't agree with the travel ban doesn't mean it's not going to stand. So part of democracy is being able to disagree on policies, and I think this is one that we don't agree with. Republicans have said before this that the travel ban started during the Obama administration, but in fact, the travel ban was Americans not being able to travel to the locations that were listed out in the travel ban. So it's a little different from the Trump travel ban.
Right, right, and I get the idea of a policy difference. You and I have talked about this before. That's actually the problem with political dialogue in our country, that people don't just debate policy difference, they get personal here. But I do think some of the opposition from Democrats in Congress differs from the American people's mentality on this, because Democrats in Congress just fundamentally want to disagree with President Trump's policies because they dislike him as a person.
And that's absolutely true. You know, I'm not the biggest fan of Donald Trump as a person. And I think when it comes to the travel ban, I think that there's problems that are bigger than the travel ban itself. I think if we want to secure our borders, I think if we want to ensure that we're not having a terrorist attack here, then we need to make sure that homegrown terrorism isn't the problem. Because, you know, a lot of the terrorism that's happened in the United States has been domestic terrorism, whether it be Muslim, Christian, you know, any kind of terrorism is terrorism.
Right, I don't disagree with you on that. I mean, we've seen, there's a radical cleric, I believe, in Dearborn, Michigan, who's radicalizing actually active terrorists. He was one of the inspirations behind the London Bridge bombing. It's absolutely horrible that that kind of thing happens in our country, that it's allowed to go on in this country. But debate with me just a bit the policy of Trump's travel ban, because the courts did tweak it. I mean, it's different than it was when Trump originally issued that executive order. Not only did he issue a second one, the Supreme Court said, well, it can't target people who have a close family connection here, even if they're not a citizen of the United States. So I guess my question is, what part of this policy did Democrats not agree with? Because which one of these countries, this 6 countries that Trump is supposedly targeting, did Obama not also target?
Because I think the Democrats' problem with the travel ban itself is it's a Band-Aid approach. It doesn't really address the issue that we're dealing with, which is terrorism and securing our border. The terrorist attack that occurred on September 11th here in New York wasn't by individuals that were already here illegally. It was by people who had gone through visa applications. And so I think that the terror ban, or rather the travel ban, doesn't address those issues specifically. None of them came from the 6 states, or countries rather, that are listed in the travel ban. They came from Saudi Arabia.
Right.
And so to not address the actual concerns, i.e., you know, Iraqi citizens or Saudi Arabian citizens coming over, I think kind of negates it and makes it seem more of a political talking point.
Wait a second, let me get it straight here. So are you telling me you, as a liberal, Michael, are advocating for extreme vetting before people are allowed legally into our country?
I think we already have extreme vetting. You know, for an individual to come into the United States, they have to go through a really extensive process. It's not like they just show up here and then they're allowed to enter as soon as they show their passport. And so I think that, you know, we can definitely refine how we go about letting people in. But just carte blanche saying, you know, if you're Muslim from a certain Muslim-based country, you can't get in, that's against everything we're about.
Well, wait a second. Answer me this then. Which countries export radical Islam? We know that there are extreme terror groups, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, mm-hmm. Al-Nusra. We could name a whole bunch whose goal it is to establish a global caliphate, to take out the West, to bomb and kill and murder and maim America and westernized nations. I mean, which nations around the world sponsor that sort of thing?
The biggest sponsor of international terrorism is Saudi Arabia. They're the ones who export Wahhabism all around the world. And so I think that if we want to really look at terrorism itself, we need to look at how we relate to countries like Saudi Arabia, how we relate to countries like Iran and Hezbollah. You know, the terrorist attacks that have happened in the United States overwhelmingly haven't been by Muslim Americans. In fact, they've been by Christian Americans. And as a Christian, I'm willing to say that we need to address those concerns as well.
Well, certainly, certainly. But that's also a common pivot point, I think, that liberals use when we're talking about this. It's really a separate topic. We have to identify the motives behind each person. But just because different terrorists have different motives doesn't mean we could ignore one in favor of the other. But in addition to Saudi Arabia, I mean, we have Iran. They are arguably the leading state sponsor of terrorism. I mean, their government sponsors terrorism. We can't have those people coming into our nation without extreme vetting. We know that they want to wipe Israel off the face of the earth. We know that they sponsor terrorists who come here to our country to kill us. I don't think that this is a band-aid in the negative sense. Perhaps it's a temporary band-aid, because it is temporary, 90 or 120 days, depending on the nations here. But there have been 78 individuals in our nation who've been convicted of terror-related charges who have come over from these six nations. That, to me, that band-aid is preventing a lot more serious bandages that we'd be issuing to our people once they were attacked, if these attacks had actually happened.
I would love to see the Trump administration actually issue their plan that they were supposed to. After the initial ruling, the Trump administration was supposed to issue a plan within 90 days to say how they were going to go about tackling our issues with visas, H-1 visas and work visas. And we have yet to actually find out that information. You know, I think a lot of this has to do with the communication between the White House and Congress, specifically Democrats. There's such a mistrust between Democrats and the White House that there's no level of political capital going on between the two.
Right, right. But just going back to that number, I mean, 78 people have been convicted. There are over 1,000 open investigations into terror-related charges from individuals that came from these six nations. I mean, should we not have this policy? Should we allow more of these people into our country, put our neighbors, our families, yours and mine, Michael, at risk?
You know, as someone who lives in New York and was in D.C. on 9/11, I am absolutely sensitive to fears of terrorism and national security. But we have to make sure that we're not changing who we are as a country and what our values are to protect us, because, you know, we don't want to give up our freedom, give up our values to the terrorist. And so I think we should put in methods and ways to ensure that we're being safe. But we don't want to give up who we are. And I think
I don't think we are. I understand that and I appreciate that. I don't think we are, though, because our fundamental values are protecting the life, liberty, and property of every man, woman, child in this nation, regardless of who they are. I mean, our fundamental philosophy on which our country was based was that every person should be able to live their lives without being either subjected to the tyranny of government or killed for something that they don't deserve to be killed for. We have to put our people first. That doesn't mean that we're being discriminatory towards other people, but once we put our people first, then we can accept more people, outsiders, into being in our country. That's the safe way to do it. And I think the primary role of our government is to protect us, and they should be putting us first. Michael, thanks for coming on the show. Thanks for being willing to have this conversation.